Yeah, very good.
Now.
Good.
I left my heart in San Francisco, high on a hill. It calls to me to be where little cable cars climb halfway to the stars. The morning fog may chill the air. I don't my love waits there in San Francisco above the blue and windy sea. San Francisco, your golden sun will shine for me.
Now, Asha ji is going to give you the history of San Francisco.
I'm not sure if any of you have been to all the sites that Veena ji just showed us, but the reason we chose the song is it's a famous iconic song. And who knew that you would all be the lucky people to live in the most beautiful, the most interesting, the most liberal, the most experimental city on the face of the world and of America. Many of us who came to the Midwest had never imagined that we would be in the West Coast and enjoying such beautiful scenery and also liberation of the mind and ideas. So there's a saying that whatever happens in San Francisco today, the rest of the nation will follow. Maybe in 10 years and 12 years, depending on where the places are. So who were the first people in San Francisco? As you know, Columbus was looking for Indians and they ended up in America, but the Spanish had also sent people to look for this famous harbor. And the first Spanish explorer to come actually landed in a small alcove near, he was looking for the Bay of Monterey, but he ended up in the Bay of San Francisco. And when he came here, he found there were early Native Americans, and they are called the Yalamu tribe of the Ohlone. And any of you who live in Fremont have heard the word Ohlone, and it comes from our Native Americans who lived here before any other settlers came to this continent. And the thought is that many of them migrated from the Bering Strait that connects Asia with the continent here. So who was the first Spanish Europeans? The military came, they established forts in the 1769, and then they established missions. So agar aap California travel kar rahe hain, you'll find there are missions everywhere along the coast. So Mission San Jose in Fremont, Carmel is a mission, Santa Barbara is a mission. And what the missions were they were really religious organizations, but they were also meant to make the Native Americans convert to Catholicism, Christianity. This was Catholicism at the time. The British are Anglicans and Protestants, but this was Catholicism that was coming. And the people who first came belonged to the Order of Saint Francis. And that's Francis of Assisi, who was a famous monk who really helped the poor, and that's how our name came about. So 1821, we are Alta, that means the higher part of California, versus Baja, which is still existing. And we are part of Mexico, but it's so far away that literally I'm told that this American Ulysses S. Grant puts his flag in and nobody's around to question him. So the first Mexican-American war was won in 1847, and the Mexicans ceded the territory to the United States. And that included Texas, Arizona, and many other parts of the Western diaspora here. So at the time, a treaty was signed with Mexico and was called the 1848 Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. And just as soon as that was done, the first gold was discovered. Please stay with the previous one, Veenaji. Thank you. That's where the gold rush started. So this was the miners of John Sutter discovered the first nugget of gold. And suddenly everybody was rushing to California. The Europeans were coming, the Mexicans were coming. There were so many of them. Now you'd say, why 49ers? And as you can see, I'm wearing a 49ers hat. It was because 1849 was the biggest, the most number of people came for the gold rush in 1849. And they brought a flood of treasure seekers. And when they would land in their ships, they would leave the ships in the San Francisco Bay and move north towards Yukon, towards Canada, where the gold country was. And during that time, a lot of people made a lot of money, not just the gold seekers. In fact, John Sutter and his friends never made it, but the people, the merchants who came along because of the influx of so many people were the ones who made it rich. Levi Strauss, you know, the people who make denim jeans, they've made it a household word. They were started in 1849. Ghirardelli Chocolate, unki building hai San Francisco mein. And Wells Fargo Bank, usme they would go on this horse and carriage and deliver your cash to you and pick up bonds, etc. This was all happening during the gold rush. And since we were so rich at that time, within 2 years after having got our territory, we were granted statehood. So California in 1850 becomes a state. So now what does the state need? It needs to develop. It needs railroads. It needs infrastructure. So there's mining going on. The railways are coming. Where do you get the labor? So since we are close to the Pacific, the Chinese were brought in to build railroads. And unfortunately in 1882, there was a backlash against them and there was the Chinese Exclusion Act, banning immigration from China. But I have to tell you a very interesting story. A lot of them that were coming to a place called Angel Island. This was it's the Ellis Island on the west. So jo Pacific routes are there, and that included the Sikhs, that included people from India. And today, if you take a trip from Tiburon, take the ferry to Angel Island, it's a great trip. And you can spend a day there. They have a little museum. Or museum mein bunks lage hue, you know, little beds. And each bed has a little briefcase from the place where these people were coming. So you might see an Italian beret. And the only thing missing was I didn't see a Sikh turban. So that was interesting, but they depict the ancestry of the people coming through. So they would be checked at immigration, and this is the inspection they would go through. So if you were deaf, or if your eyes were affected, if you were anyway handicapped, then you were turned away. And so this was the immigration process, and people were held there before they were allowed to come into the mainstream. So 1860 to 1890s, we were called the Paris of the West. There's beautiful buildings being made. There's lots of construction going on. In fact, Golden Gate Park was done to mimic Central Park on the East Coast in New York. And we have this wonderful space in the middle of the city, which is green. It has, you know, the Japanese tea garden. It has a lot of elements. It has several museums, including my favorite Asian art museum used to be there before it moved. It has the Legion of Honor, California Academy of Sciences, lots of museums, lots of open areas. And the most beautiful building is the Conservatory of Flowers. And I know Veena Ji is saving a special surprise where she'll show you a picture. And if you ever go there, it's such a treat. In fact, hum kisi ki shaadi pe wahan gaye the, and the most fascinating plants and flowers are there. But the most interesting is the carnivorous plant, jo insects ko khud khata hai, is tarah ka plant. So very interesting place. So 1906 was a made, I'm sorry. I was just saying 1700 species of plants. The big event that occurred in San Francisco was 1906. At 5:12 a.m., we had an 8.25 magnitude earthquake. Around 3,000 people died, but it was not just the earthquake, it was the fire that happened after that. But it's an interesting fact, because of the fire, all the records were destroyed. So the Chinese Exclusion Act, a lot of them would have paper sons. They were not their biological sons, but to immigrate, they call them paper sons. Veenaji, let's stay with the old.
I know.
Let's stay there. And so they would get immigration because there was no record, and they could. And so we have the largest Chinese population outside of China in our city. And that's where you saw the beautiful Chinatown. They have the great parade in February for Chinese New Year. It's a must-see. It's something we all should go see. So then we come to the famous stock market crash and the depression years. But San Francisco was a big financial center, and not a single San Francisco-based bank failed. Now that's a very big feather in our cap, because that was the time there were long bread lines. People had no jobs. There was, destitution everywhere. That's when Mr. Roosevelt comes in and then develops the New Deal. All the highways are being built because he's starting all these public works. You may have heard Mr. Biden talk about the New Deal now. It's because people have had such a backlash because of the pandemic and the financial crisis. Then comes another major event. Now, until then, America has been isolationist. They're not involved with World War I too much. Now, in 1941, for the first time, see, we have the advantage of having oceans around us, so we're pretty safe. But in 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor near Hawaii. And that was a big shock to the country. And that's where Mr. Roosevelt decided to join World War II with Churchill. And that's where the Allies fought the Axis countries, if you remember. What our world is today was shaped by the events of World War II. So I highly recommend everybody read about World War II and our role in it. And one sad moment at that time was Executive Order 9066. They asked all the Japanese to go into these protective camps, although some of them and many of them had not even been born in Japan. They were American citizens. They were fighting with Americans in the army. But their thinking was that there was such public sentiment against them that their lives might be in danger. However, it was really taken to the extreme, and many Japanese ended up basically in a concentration camp. And there are many stories about it. And not until one Japanese Inui went to represent us in the Congress did we get, or was he a senator? I don't remember. He was a congressman, I think. So now we have an airport in his name, etc. And there were reparations made to them. They gave them money for the wrong that they had suffered during that time. And then this is where I've worn my funky scarf and I'm wearing my Birkenstocks. The Vietnam War brought us the hippies. Many of you in India had heard of them. They're experimenting alternative ways of living. They don't buy this nonsense that the normal conservative people are saying, that we are fighting for capitalism against communism. They don't understand why are we killing the Vietnamese for something that doesn't mean anything to us anymore. So the sad part about the Vietnam War is the veterans were not recognized as much because there was so much opposition to that war. It was not a popular war. And that also coincided with the discovery of the contraceptive pill, which gave women a chance to literally sleep around without the consequences of having too many kids. So it was like a perfect storm. And so that was where a lot of the demonstrations were taking place at UC Berkeley. If you go to Berkeley, there's actually a place, jahan pe ye tower bana hua hai, and it was called the Summer of Love. People are singing, and the slogan was make love, not war. 1970s, maybe we had a big influx of gay folks in our area. In fact, I remember that time. There are a lot of people who are discovering that they are gay, but they're not, and gay means homosexual, and they are not being accepted in the small towns of Alabama or Tennessee, but they find San Francisco is like a sanctuary city that they're allowed to express themselves. And so we had a political event at that time, 1978. Our first gay man, Harvey Milk, was elected to public office, and he was killed along with Mayor George Moscone. And that's when our famous senator, who is still in the Senate, became our first mayor. Then we come to 1989, and this is something that affected us. Meri bichiya, Manisha, yahan pe school pe thi, she was in the school here, and it's about 4:30 or so, I'm getting ready to pick her up, and where the lockers are, the whole thing begins to shake, and it's such a severe earthquake that a part of the Cypress Bridge cracks. They even had a picture of a car that had dropped. So that was another big event that happened. So earthquakes are very common, and we should all be prepared, at least with a bag or our medications, ready for such consequences of fire and earthquake. It can happen anytime. 1990 onwards, we had a different kind of gold rush. It was called the Silicon Gold, the dot-com boom, startup companies. That was stimulating our economy. And that's where a lot of Indians are coming, big migration happening. But before that, during World War I, the Gaddar Party was formed, and their memorial is in San Francisco. And this consisted of Punjabis, Hindus, Muslims. In fact, a contingent went to India to start the movement for freedom from the British, because they felt they were being discriminated against here because they were called coolie slaves and they were called Hindus. They couldn't marry, they couldn't buy land. So many Punjabis married Mexicans. You'll see in the Central Valley, lots of those marriages have happened. And it's no wonder our foods are so similar. 2011, we had the election of Edmund Lee, our first Asian American mayor of our city. And I think...
Ashaji, can you mention that the Kartar Singh was the one in 1913, he started the Gadar movement club here also, the association here. So India yes. was a part of San Francisco. Indians were part of the San Francisco, especially the part of India's movement too.
Yes, not only that, what you see in San Francisco, there are pockets. So different folks who came, they ended up in different areas, like North Beach Co-Italian sector, Manadatta. You get the best Italian food there. By the way, do you know who brought sourdough to us? In fact, it's the same bacteria that grows in our yogurt, lactobacillus. It's the French. When the gold rush was coming, the French brought sourdough bread for us. So every culture who came brought their own particular foods. In fact, it's so interesting. There's not a get together that happens today in the valley without having samosas and margaritas. So yes. We've gotten away from apple pie and Chevrolet. So we have become as American as samosas and margaritas. So that's the beauty of our area. So let's look at the architecture. So of course, the Golden Gate Bridge was a great marvel of engineering, 1933 to 37. It was the longest suspension bridge. And I was really impressed that it holds as much weight as it does. and it's been constantly renovated. But it's so interesting. They had decided that the color would be white. However, they had just put this pre-coat, and as the fog came in, this beautiful orange structure rose up, and they said, you know what, let's keep the same color. So that's how it's been painted. And why the fog? So we are actually climatically a cloud forest. The warm air from the bottom Pacific Ocean meets the northern cold air. And that's why you get this wonderful marine layer, which is so dreamlike. If you look at the picture, aapko wo yaad aa jati movie wo kaun thi jo kohra mein se nikal rahi hai. And every time you drive through the tunnel, it's like a beautiful vista opens up. And it is just such a lovely area to travel in. In fact, in 1970s, I had seen this movie called The Graduate, jisme Dustin Hoffman is in a open air car, and he's driving on the double bridge, the Bay Bridge, which is a double decker bridge. And who would think that I would land up in the same beautiful area several years later? So Alcatraz Island is famous because it was a prison and not too many people escaped from it. And the ones who did, they haven't found them yet. It was used as a military installation also. The Coit Tower, you saw that white tower in the picture of Frank Sinatra, that was done to honor the firefighters when the earthquake occurred. And this was a famous, very rich lady, Lillian Hitchcock, who devoted this tower in their memory. But to me, the story of the Palace of Fine Arts is a story of resurrection of San Francisco. So 1906, May, we are razed to the ground. Not a building exists, everything is decimated. But in 1915, we are already back. We host the Panama Pacific Exposition. It's a beautiful area. It's a great spot now for pre-wedding photos, and very lovely. There's a little water there. It's something you should go see. You also saw the Serpentine Street, the Lombard Street. And then right around the Presidio is a place called Alamo Square, that's called Fort Point. And then Transamerica Building was the tallest until the Salesforce Tower came. So it's now the second tallest building. And Chinatown is beautiful. You can go spend a day just enjoying the food, also getting the best deals. You can even bargain in Chinatown. It's a lot of fun. And when the Olympics happened, the opening ceremonies were held in Japantown. So we have these areas where these communities were, where the culture is exhibited. And San Francisco is perhaps the only place which has an Asian art museum devoted just to Asian art. And I love that museum because isi pe rokenge ek minute ji, shukriya.
Sure.
Thank you. So how did I get involved with the Asian Art Museum? The building you're looking at was actually the San Francisco Library. And they moved from there, from the Golden Gate Park, as I mentioned to you before, to this location. And what they did to the building was amazing. Aapko zaroor dekhna chahiye. It was a lady architect who, like I am Pai at the Champs-Élysées in Paris, built a tower, just a glass tower, to connect both the wings. So it's a magnificent building, it's beautiful. And I love doing storytelling there. We have a school program. So when I get off of BART, I walk through the United Nations Square. I'm in front of Civic Center. By the way, you're looking at the inside of the building. That side is Simpson Hall, and you can see limestone. This is very beautiful example of neoclassical architecture. It's a great venue to come and listen to lectures. But what the theme of the Asian art is the story of Buddha's birth in India. So we ask you to start at the third floor. So you have the Gandhara Buddha. Now the Gandhara Buddha looks like an Indian. He has a mustache. Of course, he has the urna. He has the long earlobes. And then how Buddhism traveled through Asia. So to Japan, to China, to Korea. And it follows that whole path through Asia. Now we've added the Philippines. And it's something I would highly recommend everybody to go. And one day I'll probably do a story on it. But there's a link to Savitri, and I can share that with you sometime.
Gorgeous, gorgeous building.
It is a
gorgeous display there too, Ashaji.
Yes, and I, as Veena ji was mentioning, we had a famous entrepreneur here, Mr. Kapani, and he donated a Sikh gallery in the museum, which is the first of its kind. There is no gallery that's devoted just to Sikh artifacts. And it's very interesting, they have a helmet, just be a thoda sa bodhi si bani hui hai. And I often ask the kids, why do you think that is? And then you can tell them that the Sikhs don't cut their hair and it's to allow for the knot. And we have someone in our community, Mr. and Mrs. Khanna, jo Ranjit Singh ki court se connected the unki family, to unka ek angaraka. Angaraka, I don't know how to translate it, a tunic, is also in the museum. So we have some beautiful artifacts from Mohenjo-daro. We have the bronzes. We have a beautiful structure of Kartikeya with Ganesh, Shiva, and Parvati. And that's the first time I learned how Ganesha got his trunk. Why does the moon wax and wane? Very interesting. And the fact ki Surya Devta ki do wives hai, Usha and Sandhya.
Sandhya.
So I will leave it at that. Veena ji, it's all yours.
Okay. So maybe one day we will all take a tour to San Francisco Asian Art Museum. So I'm going to take you to the next place, which is also very historical. Please look at this picture very carefully. The, on the right-hand side, the beautiful bath. Can you imagine such a beautiful bath in San Francisco? Those days, there were no swimming pool in San Francisco. You know, the San Francisco is built on almost over 50 hills. All San Francisco was hills. So there was no reason for people, or there's no way for them to have so much land to have pools. So look at these pools here. And I'm going to go through a little bit history of that one. See, on March 14, 1896, Sutro Baths were opened to the public as the world's largest indoor swimming pool establishment. And the person who built this one was a wealthy businessman and former mayor of San Francisco, Adolf Sutro. Six saltwater pools and one freshwater pool. During high tides, water would flow directly into the pools from the nearby ocean, recycle 2 tons US gallon of water, US water within an hour. During the low tides, a powerful turbine water pump was built inside cave at the sea level, could fill the recycled water in 5 hours. In 5 hours, can you imagine that? Due to very high operating cost, later on, they closed all these pools, which I will show you the picture. And that one has 2,700. See, they were equipped with 7 slides, 30 swimming rings, and 1 springboard. 2,700 seats, amphitheater, and club room, and capacity for 1,100 people. 570 private dressing rooms and ice skating rink. 1964, property was sold to a builder, but 1966, fire destroyed the building before construction. So you can see this. It looked like this, such a beautiful, and then the dome under that was the pools. And it's destroyed by, and now it looks like this. But I tell you, I still enjoy going this place. It's a very small walk from the main road coming to down there. Beautiful scenery. Every time you go, scenery looks very different. And the ocean waves are touching these walls. And the sound is so beautiful. You will feel like meditating in that area. And here are the one I was telling you, they put here are the turbine generators who are put it in these caves. So the salt water, they can take it from there and put into the tanks. And this is the walkway. Please do visit this place. Sometime you have to rejuvenate yourself. And these are the best places to go and walk around. And you feel like oh my gosh, we live in heaven. So next place, I'm going to take you to the Cliff House. Cliff House is very close to the Sutro Center. Basically, it's a walking distance. And first Cliff House was built in 1863 by Senator John Buckley and C.C. Butler. In 1887, Adolf Sutro bought the Cliff House. In 1887, the schooner abandoned the burning of oil lamps and cargo, including dynamite powder, which exploded. In 1896, Adolf Sutro rebuilt the Cliff House. In 1907, burned to the ground of the evening of September 7. Can you imagine it look like this before? It's so beautiful. But 1907, and look at this. This one, the people are enjoying at that ocean beach there. 1907 burned to the ground. 1909, Dr. Emma married. She's the daughter of Mr. Sutro. Commissioned Reed and Reed to rebuild the Cliff House in a new classical style. 1937, George and Leo Whitney purchased the Cliff House. 1977, acquired by NPS, National Park Services. In 2004, it was renovated to original 1909. The Cliff House have two restaurants and they have a casual dining area also. You can just go and have a tea and something like that. But due to COVID, it was closed. San Francisco Board of Supervisors urging NPS to find an immediate vendor for the restaurant. Once it is open, I really tell everybody to go and visit this place because it's so beautiful. You could see it is right at the ocean there. See, you can sit in this restaurant here. You feel like you're sitting in a big ship there and watching these. There used to be seals here. They have moved them from here. There should be sea lions and seals here before. And it's called Seal Rock. And you can have a cup of tea, coffee, lunch. And they have a formal dining there also, which is a very beautiful room covered with the yellow and golden drapes there. It's a worth going places. Please do visit that. This building is still existing, but right now it is closed because of COVID. My next favorite place is Mission District. The Mission has historically been the center of city's Chicano and Mexican-American community. Mission District includes Potrero Hill, Knob Hill, Castro, and Cesar Chavez Street, Bernal Heights, Noe Valley, and south of Market is all Mission District. Mission District was inhabited by Ohlone people prior to the arrival of Spanish missionaries, as Asha Ji mentioned all that. Spanish priest Francisco Palu founded Mission District. Alta California Mission was established in 1776. I want to show you that. It looked like this. It is still there. Mass still goes on there. It is a very beautiful place. And it is the oldest standing building in California, and very close to the Dolores Park also. And 1868, first professional baseball stadium in California City was also in a Mission District. 1,700 seats were there. And it is still there, but now they have something else there running. 1868, Mission High School was established in 1819. I want to show you the Mission High School here. This was the first and the oldest high school in San Francisco. It is across from Dolores Park, rebuilt in 1927 in Mediterranean Revival style. And the next one is Dolores Park. Everybody knows about the Dolores Park. If you've never been to there, please do go there. It is vibrant, vibrating place. So many young people are there. Most popular park in the city of San Francisco in the Mission District. It attracts 7,000 to 10,000 people on sunny day, especially on the weekend. There were, originally there were two cemeteries there, which they moved in 1868 and 1905, city of San Francisco bought this park land for $291,000. And this park is very beautiful. Recently, they again renovated this. And especially if you have a small grandchildren, must take them there. It's a beautiful park for children to play around to. And they have tennis court and a lot of other stuff is there too. My next slide is here is what is happening in Mission area. Mission area, if you go there, you feel so live there. Like, you know, you feel like you're 18 years old again. And Carnival of San Francisco is one of the largest celebration of Memorial Day weekend there. And it goes on 2 days. So it's a diverse Latin American, Caribbean. And the last time when I went there, it is maybe 4 years back, there was a Bhangra group also. And I said, balle balle, I was very happy to see that. So you must go, it's a very colorful parade. It happens during the Memorial Day weekend, as I mentioned. So anytime anybody wants to go, I will go with you. So next one is the murals in Mission District. This is the must-see thing is, a lot of free tours are available in San Francisco. One of them is this mural tours, which I have taken several of them. And as Ashaji may not have mentioned, but Ashaji knows, in city of San Francisco have a lot of free tours for different buildings. So maybe next time, maybe we will organize one of those tours. Throughout the mission walls and fences are decorated with the murals initiated by the Chicano art mural movement of 1970. And the painted, first time it was painted by a very famous person, Diego Rivera. Mission District is also very famous. Before I show you this one, I want to mention to you, the Mission District is very famous for its restaurants. And there's a 5 Michelin stars restaurant. In 2017, there were 5 of them in a Mission area. San Francisco has dozens, you know, Mission Burrito, that has come also from San Francisco, from Mission area. There's dozens of Mexican restaurants are in that area. Excellent food. Vegan food is excellent. There's a restaurant named Above the Ground. I love that food. And some of my favorites are Cantina. If somebody is there, knows their pastries and coffees. Always there's a line of 50 people there. La Taquera, Daflina, Byride. The best ice cream you will ever eat is a Byride ice cream. It is at the intersection of Dolores and 16th Street. Must go and eat that ice cream. Any relatives comes, I take them there. Even in the winter, they say, oh, we don't want to eat it. Once they eat it, they all love it. Before they tell me, just get 2 ice cream. Then everybody wants their own ice cream. It's so good ice cream. And the Dolores Cafe are my favorite one. And now I'm going to play you one slide here. It's a street art. Please see carefully.
Thank you.
just say something about the mural? The first thing you saw was Frida Kahlo. She's a famous artist. She was married to Diego Rivera. But the most important pictures are really about Cesar Chavez. He was a famous farm movement social worker who made conditions better for the Mexican workers, because a lot of them, we actually have a law in place that allows temporary workers to come just for the harvest. But of course, it's created a lot of the legal issues and you keep hearing about it. But he was a famous man that did a lot for better conditions, like having the 8-hour day, having proper bathrooms, having water, wearing a hat. All of these things came about because of Cesar Chavez. So a lot of it is very political. You almost saw the political history of the Chicanos that came to this area. And don't forget, we're sitting on their land. It's their culture.
Yes,
if you look at the names, El Camino Real, all of these are all Spanish names. So learning Spanish is important for your kids. And I just wanted to mention one other thing. Veenaji, the sutro baths were done because polio was very common at the time.
That's true.
And we had a president who ended up with polio, Mr. Franklin Roosevelt. And fortunately, he would always show himself above. Wo apne calipers or crutches ko nahi dikhate the, because he wanted to show himself as being a strong person. But he had started this whole issue of baths, and because hydrotherapy was very helpful for polio. So I just wanted to mention that that was really the Renaissance coming to us. You know, if you go to Italy, they always have these baths. Roman baths were there because they knew the value of water. So that's
even Turkey. Turkey also did the same thing. Yeah, thank you, Asha ji, for giving more information. So whenever you guys, everybody have time, please do visit the mission mural. They depict the social issues of our community. So the next one, we all know this houses here, Painted Ladies, and how they had these houses. Were built in San Francisco between 1849 to 1950. In 1906, San Francisco earthquake destroyed many mansions of Knob Hill area and some other hills. So, and the World War I and II houses were, so then they decided to build these smaller houses. So the World War I and II houses were painted battleship gray. And that was the paint surplus left over from the Navy paint. You know, the Navy had that paint. So they used those houses. In 1963, San Francisco artist Butch Cardam used intense blue and green and some other brighter colors in Italianic style Victorian houses. So a lot of people objected that. They did not like it. But a lot of people liked it, and they start copying his style of the colors and everything. So then you will see in San Francisco, the house could be mustard yellow or green and all that, because this city is so vibrant. So he wanted to give the new color in the city. So that's what happened. So this is what I wanted to show. And these houses were built in 1892 to 1896. By Matthew Kavanagh, who lived next door in 1892 mansion. And one of his daughter, I play bridge with her. She lives in Orinda. So that's why I wanted to show these houses. They look beautiful. We don't know. And with these houses, they cannot remodel them from outside. They cannot change the face of these ones. These are kept as it is. It is near Alamo Square. So I hope one day when you go there, you know the history of these squares then.
So Veena ji, you know why it's called Knob Hill? I thought this would be interesting for our people to
know.
It comes from the word nabob. The British made nabob, and in San Francisco, it became Knob Hill.
Knob Hill.
We have a Russian hill, so where there's a Russian beautiful church, Orthodox church. So you'll see wherever different communities came, they put their mark on that area. These are the Victorian houses, yes.
Yes. And then next is Palace of Fine Art, as Asha Ji was saying. It is a beautiful place. I have been to two weddings there. It is so beautiful. Originally constructed in 1915, as you mentioned, for Panama Pacific Exposition. Rebuilt from 1964 to 1974. The most prominent is 160 feet high. It doesn't look from the, when you are driving by, it doesn't look as big. But once you go there, it is a very huge rotunda here. It is 162 feet high, open rotunda, enclosed by a lagoon on one side, and exhibition hall is on the back of this one, and which is separated from this lagoon by this colonnades here. So this is very beautiful. It looks like you are in ancient Rome or ancient Greek architect they have given it. So it's a beautiful place. And the, it's nice if you go sometime in the evening time, because the lights comes up, and once it's lighted, it looks so romantic there. You don't have to be romantic, but you feel romantic when you're walking around there. And another thing is Lucas Film Foundation embellished plaque on the floor underneath this dome here, underneath the dome. And you can see on the ceiling also, they have, I think there's eight figures. The four is like birth and commitment to the earth, acceptance by the human intellect, some of those things. And then they have a poppies, citric fruit, metallic gold, and wheat. It's all in the ceiling up there. These eight things are on there. If you go, please note that thing. You may have seen this Palace of Art in one of the movies, Hindi movie, My Name is Khan.
Oh, is that right, Veena ji, I think it's got all the mascots of California. So yes. Our flower is the poppy, the golden poppy. Our bird is the quail, grizzly bear, so on and so forth. And that's wheat. Why our colors are blue and gold, blue for the sky, because the sky is the limit, it's our thinking, and gold because gold was found here. So
yes. In 1970s, I remember going there and watched a lot of Satyajit Ray's movies. They have a theater there also. But now I don't know if the theater is still there or not, but they used to have a theater there. So they used to show very artistic movies there. San Francisco Cable Car Museum. We all ride the cable car. This museum is free. Please take your children, grandchildren to see this museum. Cable Car Museum is a free museum in the Knob Hill neighborhood, located at 1201 Mason Street. It contains historical and some other stuff of the cable car related. Building was constructed in 1887 and restored after the earthquake. Museum was established 1974, and it is run by the Friends of the Cable Car Museum. My next favorite place is a San Francisco Ferry Building. The San Francisco Ferry Building, a Page Brown was the architect. In 1898, Ferry Building was a symbol of San Francisco history. In 1930, the Ferry Building was the second busiest transit in the world. Survived both the earthquakes, 1906 and 1989. The highest quality of material was used, such as marble and mosaics for the state seal there. And that seal is still there. If you go there, please do see that. And the favorite thing is watching this market. A marketplace was created on the ground floor. The former, it was a bagging handling area. The second floor and the third floor is adopted for the offices and port commission. It is listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Anytime you go there, I think there's about 50 shops there. Lovely, this is a very good place to have a sourdough bread. And I go and sit outside. I love to go there anytime. Anybody wants to go, give me a call. I will go with you. And here it is. In the back of that building is a Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi's, our Bapu's statue in the back. Non-violence is the greatest force at the disposal of mankind. It is written on that. It is a supreme law. By it alone, mankind be saved, Mahatma Gandhi. So if you've never been there, please must go there. I love this place. I don't know. I love this place a lot. And this is our YPG. San Francisco is the most vibrant city. He sent me this picture on Father's Day from there. San Francisco is the most vibrant, friendly, colorful, foodie, walkable, great weather, beautiful sunrise and sunset. And it is built on 50 years. Home sweet home. I love San Francisco. We don't have to, I have traveled all over the world, but I find, I'm not biased, but everybody finds that this is the most beautiful city ever I have seen it. So far, I love San Francisco. I'm sure you all enjoyed our presentation. In the beginning, I had some trouble. I did this first time with everybody. So excuse me for that. Sorry for running a little late. Thank you, Asha ji, for doing such a great job presenting this presentation. See you again in San Francisco. Thank you very much for joining us.
This is the best presentation. Very good presentation.
Yes. You know, the highest place in San Francisco is the Twin Peaks, from where you can get
300
degrees views all around.
But Gigi, stop the video thing. But Gigi, you are muted.
I have to stop sharing first before I can do anything. Stop sharing. Go back to your presentation and just say stop share. Okay. Very good. Perfect. Perfect. Very nice.
Anybody have a question?
No question, but we just want to say that excellent presentation, Veena ji and Asha ji, both lovely. In any case, I love this city very much, but your presentation was